Hi out there! Today I want to talk about precision step attenuators as they are built in our RF generators. And you might know step attenuators are really needed because it is the only decent way to bring a level down. So I'm talking about devices like this here. So this is a Hewlett-Packard Agilent Keysight, whatever you want, step attenuator, which is sitting in our RF generators or in our mobile test gear or wherever we have to attenuate signals. And well, this one I was able to acquire on a flea market. And it was not even a radio flea market, as you might expect. No, it was a normal general flea market. And suddenly I saw this little unit. And I was not really able to figure out if this unit fits into my signal generator as spare part, but after I have compared the number which is written down here, I am now sure it is exactly this step attenuator. And that is great, because this is a nice spare part, because when this RF generators are failing, it is really very often this kind of step attenuators, because then you get problems with your output level and such, and then very often these guys are failing. And well, so I really purchased it for a little money, and well, now I thought it might be interesting for you to figure out, first of all, how can we test a device like this, because as you know, it is not built in my RF generator, so it is outside. And you can see here on the side we have an interface, and that means this is a programmable step attenuator, so you need to give some electrical information into this interface to switch the let me call it relays. This is not completely right, but let me call it relays, because you have different pads inside, and then you switch these pads in and out. And that is how this step attenuators works. But up to now, I don't know really if this particular unit is working or not. So it is also interesting for me to know if it is working or not, because there are so many different problems which can happening over the time. And therefore, it is really highly interesting to know what we need to put to these contacts, and then are all pads which are in here are working or not. So that is what we're going to do today. And so you may learn a bit about these attenuators, how they work, and how we can test them. And well, maybe I have really a nice step attenuator as a spare part for my RF generator if something happens to my internal, in the moment, working step attenuator. But well, you never know. So let's go and see what we can do with this guy here. Well, the challenge with devices like this is that there are not many informations on the internet, so no schematic, no detailed information. And therefore, yeah, it could be a little bit tricky because the only information we have is that this is a 24 volt DC unit, and other than that is not really available, and yeah, that makes it to a kind of challenge. But I was minimum able to find a kind of block diagram for you to explain a little bit how it works. So, as I already said, there are pads inside this kind of step attenuators, and these pads are the attenuator cards or pads, however you want to call it, and these pads have a different attenuation steps. So, for instance, we have in this attenuator we have a 60 dB pad, and we have a 40 dB pad, and a 20 dB pad, and a 10 dB pad. And with these four different pads, we are able to switch between 0 and 130 dB in 10 dB steps. So that is how it basically works. And you can see we have always two conditions. One through line condition, and then if this is switching, then the pad is in, and if it is like this, the pad is out. So that means as it is as this drawing is done, you see that all are through line, and that means there is no attenuation between the input and the output. And these relays here are switching the pads in and out, and so you are able to have the different attenuations depending on the pads which are switched in. So that is the whole secret, and well, you need to put your 24 volt DC to one of the contacts, and then we need to find the ground, and well, then we need to find how we can stimulate our step attenuator that the pads gets switched in and out. The problem is this diagram does not fit to my step attenuator, so it is different, and therefore this here will only give us a rough idea how it works, and we get a feeling how we can do our approach, but that's it. We have to find a solution to see what we need to put to this interface. Okay, and I have already opened the site because I want to show you how easy it is. This was only what we have here at this edge. So you can take it away, and then you can simply slide off this device. But first, before we do this, we have to remember this is the ESD device, so therefore we have to wear our ESD protection. So that is very important, because otherwise you simply can damage your internal circuitry. So therefore wear your wrist brand. Okay, so then we simply slide it off like so, and yeah, what you can see is the PCB with all the integrated circuits on it, and here on this side we have the magnets, and you can easily see that we have four magnets, so that means we will definitely have four attenuation pads,
And the attenuation pads are down here inside. And you know, yeah, where can we see it? Maybe we can see it here a little bit more clear. So this is this magnet, and this magnet, or yeah, it is in reality it is called a solenoid, and this solenoid is switching this both conditions, the through condition or the attenuation or attenuator card. And well, so we see we have four, and you can see that we have here some informations on the device. 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is a 60 dB pad, 20 dB pad, 40 dB pad, and 10 dB pad. So that is already very, very helpful. And well, that means we need to find a way to identify what we have to connect to these contacts. Okay, so first of all, I try to identify where or how the solenoids are switched, and if I look here into this gap, I can see that all solenoids are on the same position. So if we are lucky, that would mean, maybe you can see it a bit better when I zoom it in. So yeah, what I'm interested in is this here. Yeah, we have this for solenoids, and well, let me see if we can see the little plungers, which has to be down there. So maybe with some more light. I'm not sure if you can see them, but down there, there are the little plungers which get moved by the solenoid. So that means if this pad will get engaged, then the solenoid works the plungers down, and the respective attenuator pad will be then engaged. So that is how they are working. And yeah, for the moment in time, you can see, yeah, here you may see it a bit better. It's a little, yeah, it is a little bit yellow, I would say, the little plunger down there. And for me, it is in the upper position. So that means that they are not, obviously, not engaged, hopefully, but that is what we can easily check with our multimeter. So we simply, so we assume that for the moment in time, there is no attenuator card engaged, and that would mean we have no attenuation at all. And that means when I now take here my probes and put it to our contacts here, yeah, you can hear it. So our assumption was right. So there is no attenuation at all. So all attenuators are bypassed. So, well, okay, that is definitely an information we can use. Well, and the next we need to figure out is, can we find our plus 24 volt pin? So that is the next important thing, because we know that it is a 24 volt DC attenuator, and that means most likely that the solenoids, so the magnets, are driven by 24 volt. So that means we should watch out for contacts, and this here, for instance, could be a contact, or this here. Here we have a contact, and here we have a contact. So maybe we are able to figure out if these contacts here are going somehow to this to this contacts outside, and well, so that could be then our 24 volt plus contact. Okay, so I have played around a little bit, and as I already said before, we have here the contacts which are connected to our magnet. So most likely this is in any kind our 24 volt line in any way. And yeah, what I found out is that when I take the first contact down here, I have at least 149 ohm at all of these contacts here, and that means this really could be the coil in between of the this kind of relay. So this could be really our 24 volt connection somehow. I was not able to find the same connection to any of the other contacts here. So I believe this is really a good chance that my assumption is right, but I'm not 100% sure up to now. Well, but as I already said earlier, we need to do a little bit reverse engineering, and the easiest way is to go to the internet and watch out for the data sheets for the ICs which are used here inside. And one IC, and that is very easy to identify, is a LM7805. So that means this here is a 5 volt regulator. And well, if this is a 5 volt regulator to supply all the other integrated circuits we have down here, then this will get the power supply from our 24 volt line. But I don't believe that this voltage regulator is able to take directly 24 volt. So I believe that there is another component in between to reduce it a little bit to a lower amount, because 24 volt is definitely too much for this little IC. Okay, and this is a data sheet of our voltage regulator, and what we need to find out, where is the input of the regulator, and that is what we can see here. So pin 8 is our input, and well, we have more than one ground pin, but anyway, our pin 8 is the input, and therefore for me, it is very interesting now to see where a little bit closer. What is with our focus? Come on. Yeah, okay. So that means pin 8, which is this one here, is our input. And yeah, pin 1 is output, but I'm interested where does our input go to? Because as I already said, I do not believe that this pin will directly get 24 volt. So I believe there is another component in between. And we can see here a little transistor. And I believe that this little transistor is in between and will somewhat reduce the voltage coming from the connector. Okay, so let it check it out with our multimeter again. And yeah, let's go to pin 8, which is down here, and now to this little transistor. And you hear this? So great, there is a direct connection between this little transistor and the voltage regulator, and that means this device will somehow reduce the voltage for this IC, and that means that most likely this little transistor is directly connected to our connector. And yeah, let me see if we can get it arranged somehow. So I will then take this pin, which I have already identified as most likely the one which is carrying our 24 volt. And yeah, let me simply go to this point, and yeah, so that really looks very, very good. So I believe that therefore our pin 1, so I call it now pin 1, this one, this guy here, is our 24 volt DC supply. So because this picture is really makes sense to me. So if we have direct connection from pin 1 to this little transistor and from the transistor to the voltage regulator, so that really makes sense. And therefore I'm now, let me say, 99% sure that this is our plus 24 volt pin. Well, but here on the board are also some other integrated circuits, and we should find out what kind of integrated circuits we have here as well. And therefore, yeah, you can easily see it. This is a 74HC123. So that is, I believe, that could be a flip-flop or something like that. So we will figure it out, because I will go and search for the data sheet. And then we have this guys here, which are ULM2003, which I do not really know right now what it is, but no problem. I will go and search for the data sheets. Okay, and here it is, the MM74HC123A is a monostable flip-flop. So that makes sense. And we have here the internal circuit of our monoflop. So That is good to have. And secondly, we have the ULN2002, or was it? Or was it another unit? Was it 03? What was it? 03. But anyway, this is also for the 2003, and yeah, this is a high voltage, high current Darlington transistor arrays, and that means it makes sense as well, because the monoflops, this ICs can't really drive the magnets, so this wouldn't work. So that means these are the MOSFET drivers which are able to drive our solenoids, and well, the little voltage regulator is only there to supply all the ICs with their voltage, and so we can now assume that all these ICs are needing 5 volt to work, and the relays themselves needs of course 24 volt. And well, when now our flip-flop will get an impulse from outside, then this flip-flop will switch over the high voltage and high current drivers, our solenoids, and that is how it works together. So that means the next what we need to find is, where is our ground here at our connector? And that is now very easy to figure out, because as we know, the internal circuit of our monoflop, in this case, we see that pin 8 is ground, okay? And now it is very easy to probe the ground of this IC and then find the ground at our connector. And again, I have played around a little bit that it does not take too long. So we go to the ground pin, and then we look for the ground at the connector, and I have already figured out this pin here is ground. So what we now know is where our plus pin is and where our ground pin is, and that will really help us a lot. Okay, now I have connected a ribbon cable to our attenuator, and well, I just put here a red wire and a blue wire to this connector, and this both little wires are for plus and minus, and the wires are soldered to the contacts where I identified ground and plus 24 volt. So that is what I've done. And now I will supply this both wires with, not really directly with 24 volt. So we will do it very carefully, and we will crank up the voltage and see how our circuit is reacting. Okay, now the power supply is connected to our ribbon cable connector here, and I have connected as well my power supply, and I will now increase the voltage up to 20 volt, and I will see how our little circuit is reacting. And well, therefore, I will go down here. So let me see if I can come a little closer. Is it still possible to see both? I don't know. So it is a little bit dark for you. So maybe I can place it like this here. Yeah, that looks okay. And I will now connect my test pin to the input of the little transistor, which we have identified as the device, as a component which is in between our 24 volt line and our voltage regulator. And when I now cranking up our voltage, so let me try. Okay, so you see that is definitely the right pin, which we found out. So and it is showing 3.2 volt, so that is exactly the same what is showing our power supply. So okay, so let me go up to 5 volt, so everything seems to be okay. But now I will change to the input of our voltage regulator, and that was pin 8, I believe. So it must be down here. And up to now there is no voltage available, but we are only feeding in 5 volt right now, so maybe that is a little too less. So let me increase it, and now I'm feeding in 8 volt, and you already see that something is happening. 9 volt, 10 volt, and you see now it is going up. Now I'm feeding in 13 volt, and yeah, let me go up to 20, yeah, now it's 19.5, so that is good. And we have now at the input of our regulator, we have 11 volt. So that makes more sense. So let me go back to the input that you can see that as well. So there we have 19.5 volt. So that is what I'm feeding in. So that is really making sense. And at the input, we have now our 11 volt. So that means we have approximately the half of the voltage behind this little transistor. And our output, the output of our regulator is pin, what was it? One, I believe. Where is my data sheet? Yes, it is. It is one. So let me probe pin one, which is here. Yeah, brilliant. So you see 5 volt. So the regulator is really giving out 5 volt. So that is really nice. So then let us easily see if our monoflops are getting their supply voltage, which should sit at pin 16. Where? Yeah, you can see it, hopefully. Yeah, so this is a little bit tricky down here, but I hope I will. Yeah, great. Yeah, pin 16. So there is our supply voltage, and as well, let me check the next one as well. So this is pin 16, and there is our supply voltage. So yeah, that is right. And now we can conclude that we really found the right DC input pin, and we find the right output, not output, sorry, the right ground pin. So that is really great. And now we need to find a way how we can really activate or deactivate the solenoids. And I played around again a little bit, and well, I found out that we are able to move the solenoids by just bringing a negative impulse to our contact. So what I have here is only, you know, a probe, and it is connected to ground. And now I have here, oh, where is it? I have here our contact, our contacts, and now I can easily just give a negative impulse to one of the contacts, and that is enough to finally move our solenoid. So for instance, this first one, our 10 dB pad, can be easily moved. So I now, with my ground lead at our connector, and yeah, when you have a look to it, you can see here, have a look down here. So that is the interesting information we have now. Can you see it? Can you see that I am able to move the solenoid up and down by simply, let me see if I can get it into the picture as well. Yeah, maybe. So this solenoid down there, all right, and here is our negative pulse, which I give to the contacts, and you see that the solenoid down there is switching, and that is really great, because now it makes all sense. I was only guessing that with the monoflops we will need a negative pulse, because that is very often how it is designed, and it is exactly the same in here. So the monoflop, this IC, will get a negative impulse to the input, and then it will switch, and the solenoid then move up and down. And once again, yeah, you can watch this here, and you can see how it is going up and down. And that means when it is in the upper position, like so, then the attenuator pad is switched off, so that is a bypass position. And when I bring it down, now the 10 dB attenuator should be engaged. But that is what we want to check later on. Okay, so I made me a little overview of the connector. So this is the connector down here, and I simply wrote to the contacts where I have to put a negative pulse to move the 60 or either the 20 or 40 or 10 dB attenuator card to get it engaged, and where I have to place my negative pulse to disengage it. So that is what I wrote down here, and that means I'm now able to really move all the solenoids up and down. So for instance, here our 40 dB pad is this one here. I'm really on the right position. Let me see. The 40 dB is second, and here, can you see it? This one is the one which I'm moving now up and down. You can see it. So simply by the negative impulse. So that is all you need to connect to this interface, a negative pulse. It is really just a pulse, because I'm just tipping to the connector, and then you see it is moving, and that is because we have some monoflops here which are doing the job together with our with our transistor array, which we have here. So, I also can let me say the 60 dB PET, which will be number 4, and number 4 is in the upper position right now. And to bring it down, I have to give a negative impulse here, and you have already recognized that it was really going down, and to get it up, where is it? The number 4. I was doing it on number 4, and to get number 4 up, it must be which one? This here? Yeah, it is. So that is where it goes down, and here it goes up. So you see, I'm really able to move all the solenoids by simply putting a negative pulse to it. So that is telling me that the board here, our PCB, and the whole circuitry seems to be working, and I'm also able to move the solenoids. So what we do not know right now is if the attenuator pads are in good condition. So that is what we need to check in a bit. But meanwhile, you see that I have already connected here a probe to our first monoflop, our 10 dB attenuator, and I just want to see if we are able to see the pulse on our scope. So let me see if we will be able to see when the monoflop is working. So let me see what I can do here. Is it all connected? I don't know right now. Let me see. And yeah, you can see it. Have you seen it? So there we have the pulses from our monoflop, and you see it changing. Here we have it. So that is our monoflop working. Yeah, very nice. So we really can see the functionality of our monoflop. So everything is really making sense right now. And so that means we are able to move all our solenoids. So now let's check for the attenuator pad. Okay, now all our solenoids are in the upper position, and that means that we are in bypass condition. And I have now connected the tracking generator and our spectrum analyzer to the unit, and let me see if we can get it in. One moment. Okay, so this should work right now. So what you can see here, we are making a sweep from 1 megahertz up to 500 megahertz, and the tracking generator is adjusted to a level of 0 dB. So what you can see right now is that we have a line up here, and that means that we really seeing no attenuation in our attenuator right now. So what we gonna check right now is we wanna engage our 10 dB pad, and if it works, then we should see the line down here, because this is one division is exactly 10 dB, and that is what we want to see right now. And have a look. So exactly what we expect, and you see the sweep is nice and flat. I mean, It is only up to 500 megahertz. This unit should work up to 4 gigahertz, but I have BNC connectors connected to it, and so if I would go higher in the frequency, then of course the flatness wouldn't be that good, but that is most likely depending on the bad connections I have prepared here. But the only thing I want to know right now is if the attenuation cards or pads are working or not. So that is really very important. And what I can see, our 10 dB attenuator card is working. So then I switch it back to bypass, and yeah, so now attenuation is gone, and now I wanna engage my 20 dB pad. Where this contact should be the right one, and yeah, you already see now 10 dB, 20 dB. So the 20 dB attenuation card is working as well. So let me get it on bypass position. So that is here. Yeah, now it is on bypass. The next is our 40 dB pad, which is this one here. And great, 10, 20, 30, 40. Really nice, really, really nice. So three pads are working and without any problems, because as I already said at the beginning, these pads are critical as well. So maybe they get blasted by high power and then they really burned out, or they can crack, and then of course they do not work anymore. So there are also a lot of things what can happening to this attenuator pads, and therefore I'm really happy that three are working. So let me get the 40 dB pad out. So that must be this contact, and yeah, it is out again. And now the last one is the 60 dB, and 60 dB is this contact here, and oh, have a look, 10 20 30 40 50 60, and we are very close to the noise level, of course, and that is why you see this this line really noisy. So now I would need to change the settings to get the noise level a little bit down, but that is not really important right now. I mean, yeah, okay, I could do it a little bit. You see now the reading is getting better already. But let me get out the 60 dB pad, which is here. Yeah, very nice. So now what I want to show you right now, that you understand how it works together. So first of all, I'm switching in our 20 dB pad. The 20 dB pad is, let me see, it is number 3, my contact number 3, and that is here. Great. So now you see we have 20 dB now engaged, and you know that we have no pad for 30 dB, because we only have 10, 40, 20 and 60 dB. So that is what we have here in this attenuator. But to get at least a 30 dB attenuation, you simply add two pads together. And let me say we are looking for 30 dB, and that means 20 are already in, and that means I need to engage additionally to the 20 dB PET, I need to activate the 10 dB PET additionally, and that is this contact here. And great, have a look. Now we have 30 dB, 10, 20, 30. Okay, and maybe I can engage the 40 dB on top of that. Let's see if we can see that as well. So the 40 dB is contact number 2, and that is this guy. And you can see 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 80. Right? Now we are really at 80 dB attenuation. And that is how it works together. Okay, now we really can conclude all our PETs are working and in perfect condition. Our electronic, so all the components on the PCB are working. Our solenoids are working. So that means finally this attenuator is completely working and it is fine. So that means I have a spare part for my HP RF generator. So that guy down there, yeah, so that is my HP signal generator, and now I have a spare part here if something happening to my step attenuator in this signal generator, I can fix it, and that is really a good, really a good news, because this attenuators down here are really expensive. So you pay on eBay approximately $300 for this attenuator. So I've looked into the eBay offers, and you really can find them, and you have to pay $300 for this kind of attenuators. And so that is really good news. I'm quite happy that I have now a complete unit which is working. And that is all I can show you today. You see that you really can find a way how you can program your attenuator by working a little bit with reverse engineering, that you understand how it works together, and then you can check it with your spectrum analyzer, as I have shown it to you. And at least that is all I really wanted to show you, and I don't want to make it too long. I hope it was a little bit interesting for you to understand how it is working and how you can check it. Yeah, and if you like it, please give me a big thumb up for this video, and catch you next time. Bye.